Hey everyone, it's Kai
and Lafayette, and this is
The Theory of Living. Thanks for tuning in. We are able to bring you this episode thanks to our Patreon members.
Patreon is a subscription-based platform where people can provide support for content creators like us.
Thanks to our Patreon members and supporters, we are able to provide free content on the podcast and weekly episodes.
By being a Patreon member, you'll have access to our entire podcast library, full video and audio episodes, along with much more.
If you like this episode and you feel it adds value to your life,
or you hate it,
please subscribe on Patreon and or leave your review on Apple Podcast.
And don't forget to mention it to your friends over your next beer. Truly, thank you again, and we hope you enjoy today's episode. We're back. Guess who's back?
Who's back?
Okay.
You? We're us. Well, we're back.
On today, we have a very exciting guest for you. Mm-hmm. You probably can't see him because you're not in the studio with us, but he speaks Korean, and he's known multiple. But today we're going to be talking about travel.
Yes. So I'd like to start with a quote. Charlemagne, the great, Charles the Great, I'm sorry, famously said that to have another language is to possess a second soul. And, you know, this is a tribute to the fact that our ideas are bound by language. But also this expansion of cognitive capacity is also attributed to the fact that learning a new language is to immerse oneself in new culture, right? Mm-hmm. I think that's why he said it. And then, you know, I speak Korean. I grew up in Korea as well.
You speak Korean? I don't believe you.
I do.
Okay, well, for the listeners out there that know, 안녕하세요 is the formal hello. Could you lay a little more Korean on us? Just so we believe you.
Yeah, sure.
Fact check us.
What should I say?
Say the quote in Korean. Basically, loosely translate the quote.
Oh, okay. 찰리메이는 이런 말을 했어요. 다른 언어를 한다는 것은 두 번째 영혼을 갖는 것과 같다.
Oh man, I wish I could repeat that back. I can't. Somebody fact check that out there for all our Korean listeners out there.
There was a spontaneous translation, but I think it was good. But anyway, so yeah, I can really attest to that quote. I really understand what that means. You know, because you really can't separate culture and language. Mm-hmm. It's just not possible, right?
So would you say, with your experience having traveled, obviously, you've moved to the U.S. You've been here for over 10 years now. And you obviously have a very different experience with travel and language. Because a lot of people in Korea can read English to some degree. Or, you know, it's taught.
Yeah, absolutely.
So would you say, though, your experience and understanding of English and the language and the cultural elements is greater because of the travel? Do you think you have a more comprehensive understanding? I know the answer is yes, but how much differently do you think it is versus somebody who lives in Korea and can speak it, but only live in Korea?
Day and night. Completely different thing. Yeah, it's not even remotely close to what it is. Yeah, I mean, we're going to talk about this more in depth later, but like, I mean, we've talked about this so many times, even outside of this subject, which is, you know, there's massive difference between knowing it and experience it, right? I think it really aligns with that same context here, that yes, I've learned I learned English in Korea, I read a lot, I even, you know, watching TV, movies and listening to music, all those are ways of experiencing culture, right? But it is indirect experience, and there's a limit to it. Because when I say experience it, it's more than, you know, perceive it and then process it. It's actually interacting with the elements of the culture directly, firsthand. You know, I think that's the difference.
Yeah, I think in today's age, when we think of travel, we kind of summarize it in going to a beautiful place and maybe taking pictures there and recording some type of facet of our life in that environment. And we don't really take into account the cultural aspect and the requirement to actually travel, to get the full benefit of travel, you have to be adventurous.
Yes.
And what does an adventurer do? He explores. Mm-hmm. He takes action. You have to be engaged.
Yes.
So in today's age, you know, not to say everybody's victim to this, but I think we have a gross misrepresentation of what travel is. And when we hear quotes about travel, we also falsely conflate the idea of current day travel.
Yeah.
Travel meant something so much differently in the past for so many people because there wasn't an effective way to document it via pictures.
Right.
And then again, a lot of people didn't write necessarily, or if they did, it was a more personalized, stylistic journal type way.
Yeah.
And they were forced to engage with the culture. Mm-hmm. You didn't have Google Translate. You didn't have websites you could pull up.
Yeah.
You had to go and talk to somebody, potentially somebody who didn't understand you, speak your language, and try to suss out the information you needed. Yes. And build relationships out of that.
Mm-hmm.
And so you got a very different experience of travel.
Absolutely.
It's not your Instagram, Facebook, social media representation of being somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
It's actually being with the people, understanding. And then again, like you were saying, our language is bound by these concepts. And the culture uses language to relate ideas and concepts to the culture, and they play off each other.
Mm-hmm.
So just like you're saying, it's critical to engage into the culture to actually get the experience of travel. Because traveling in of itself, by definition, is just going from one place to another.
Yeah. So, yeah, I think two things I'd like to comment on your perspective. One, I agree with you that because of our technology and use of other convenient methods, you know, it really robs our, potentially, our experience, you know, in interacting with locals and interacting with the cultural elements, right? Because even small thing like, oh, how do I get to that place from here? Like, long time ago, you would have to talk to the person there, locals, to find out the way, but now you don't really have to. So it completely eliminates the interaction with people there, right?
Yes.
So in a way, I mean, that comes with a convenience too, right? Because it's a lot more convenient or a lot more effective to find a way with your Google Maps, whatever. But it really eliminates the interaction part that we can potentially have with locals there. So I guess, you know, there was a loss, but there's a gain as well.
Right? Yeah, absolutely. Again, you're still at a better position than somebody who does not travel.
Because absolutely.
By the nature of the traveling, you're going to be forced to be put in a situation where you have to engage with the culture. And then you're going to be forced to either try to bend and learn to adopt you know, certain aspects of that culture in order to have enjoyment in it.
Right.
Or you're just going to have a negative experience and never go travel again.
True. Very true. And also, we're talking about this limitation of a cultural experience with language. Like, I have a great example. So there's a Chinese letter. It's called Hyo.
Hyo.
What it is that... by the way, the word, it doesn't exist in English, by the way. I mean, you can translate, you can explain, and you can describe the concept of the word, but the word itself doesn't exist. But Hyo is a virtue of children who that takes care of their parents well. You know, that's what it means, the word itself. But the word is a combination of two different letters in Chinese. There is a one word that goes to the top of the word. It means old person or elderly. And the bottom of the word is a child. So basically, an old person on top of child, meaning that the child, the younger, takes care of the older.
Okay.
That's the combination of two words that means, defines what child should do as a, you know, as an offspring to their parents. But that word, again, doesn't exist in English, right?
Interesting.
So you can learn the concept of that word, obviously, by reading it or hearing from someone like me. But if you would talk to someone who really lived their lives with that concept, you know, in mind throughout their lives, I mean, you will have just completely different experience or description of the word through their lives, right? That's completely different things.
That's very interesting because that also pertains, at least in Japanese culture in regards to the number. The greater number is on top. Mm-hmm. So for the Japanese company I worked for, the machine when they for the films. Mm-hmm. So this is a part of the machine that receives basically the material that's going to be used. It's films one on the bottom, films two on top.
Right.
So it seems similar conceptually, at least to this. And when you can see that and understand it conceptually, all the other things in that culture, you can probably derive a specific meaning from, of importance.
Yeah.
Or what the lower one does to the higher one, hierarchically. So without that, you would just have no, you would just think, oh, they just write it that way. Mm-hmm. It doesn't actually have a meaning behind it. But in specific circumstances like this one, it, apparently it's a very strong meaning.
Yeah, it's right, true. And then, you know, you just, speaking of Japanese culture, because we've experienced that in many different ways, that if you look at their machines, especially the semiconductor equipment, they're, you know, one of the best in the world, right?
Yeah.
I mean, it's very meticulous, very precise in terms of, I mean, they still make errors just like any other machines, but comparably speaking, it's way more complex, way more precise, and easier to maintain. I mean, all of that, right? But you really see that culturally exists across the board. Like when I was in Japan, for example, I had never seen anything like that. I was going down on an escalator to get a subway, and the cleaning people were cleaning the handrail of the escalator. Wow. I had never seen anything like that in my whole life.
Wow, as it's being actively used.
Yes. Yes, that was, this was before COVID, by the way. So I was like, wow. And then another thing, the trains and subway, they were like on time, like on schedule, on the dot, like mostly, like just a few seconds difference, but mostly they operate according to the schedule.
Wow.
Yeah. And then, you know, some may say that, oh, isn't that, shouldn't that be the case anywhere? But it's not.
It's definitely not. If you've gone to and lived in a lot of different places.
So like I could experience that meticulous aspects of the culture from different elements of the culture. I mean, I had known about it. I had experienced about it. But also experiencing it in different ways was really refreshing, you know, experience.
Yeah, you can have a deeper sense of appreciation for those ideals and those ethics. And again, that's because that culture has arranged their value system in such a way that they value specific things greater than others.
Yeah.
Which is why you have that attention to detail, the precision.
Yes.
You know, being very anal about punctuality and all these other elements. But that's because they came from a historical place.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what survived over time and was passed down for many generations.
Mm-hmm.
And once you get, I mean, I think this is a wonderful thing. Mm-hmm. Once you engage with that experience and that culture, you can adapt some of those values. You have now new stimuli to understand the world can be rearranged in a different way and still be functional and better in some ways and maybe worse in other ways. But you're now exposed to something completely new and it kind of really erodes your ideals and your ideas about the way the world should be.
Yeah.
Rather than you start seeing the world as it should be, you see how it can be. And I think there's a great value in that because you can take home a lot of this stuff and incorporate in your life, in your community, and affect the culture in the place you live.
Yeah.
And that's, I mean, that's just a very empowering thing.
Yeah.
Because I think oftentimes we don't even realize there's different ways the world can be.
Mm-hmm.
But because we grew up in one place, we haven't been anywhere, and we've only been exposed to so much media or specific types of media, which are just, you know, depictions of reality cut up in a specific way.
Mm-hmm.
We're trapped in this box and think the world is one way when it's so many different ways. Like, could you imagine if we thought there was only one flower?
Yeah.
It would be crazy. That would be preposterous to even think about.
I but said yes, I can't imagine.
Oh, you can imagine? Okay, well, he can imagine.
I'm just kidding.
But a lot of people, you know, for better or worse in some situations, truly think the culture and time period they live in is the only way and the best way, just by nature being the only way.
Right.
And there's a great quote attributed to St. Augustine who said, "The world is a book, and those who do not travel have only read one page."
Yeah. Wow. That's pretty cool.
Yeah. I mean, right there, that alone should maybe cue into your perception mm-hmm. or what you think you have figured out, if you have it yeah. all figured out.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot to be said about travel.
Yeah.
And oftentimes I feel it's unfortunate that it's been capitalized on for the social status and credit, because mm-hmm. if you go travel and nothing changes mm-hmm. with your views, the way you interface with life,
mm-hmm.
That would be very unfortunate,
because
mm-hmm. it's one of the few times in your life where you're actually going to have everything challenge, and you can really think about things critically and differently,
mm-hmm.
and there can be so much joy. And like we talked yeah. about, even this is just a non-ideal representation mm-hmm. of what the experience will bring you.
Yeah.
Because it's so multifaceted. I mean, the smells are different. The mm-hmm. sounds are different.
Yeah.
Everything is just so different.
And yeah.
It's such an exciting thing to see. Or
yeah.
it might be, it can be extremely difficult too.
Yeah.
Because you're forced to deal with the realization that,
mm-hmm.
again, maybe the way you thought things are not the best mm-hmm. way, or
yeah.
you have to just kind of come to terms with that.
Right. Yeah, I think in a way that experience is powerful is that because we engage all the senses, right? It's more than when you read about other culture, read about traveling, oh, it's awesome, because, you know, even though you're not there, through words, you know, which is, you know, by basically your vision, you know, mm-hmm. you take in all the words, and then you can't, you know, stimulate the imaginative part of your brain. And, you know, that alone can be great, don't mm-hmm. get me wrong, but when you're actually there, right, experiencing firsthand, like, you use all the senses.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
That's why it is so memorable, so impactful when you're yeah. there. I'm not saying that traveling is, you know, the solution for everything, or everybody should. I mean, there are a lot of arguments actually against traveling too. I mean, against the idea that you have to be there and experience it firsthand to get the benefits of traveling, right?
Mm-hmm.
Expanding your, you know, horizons. I mean, that's the most common expressions used. All that, but there are arguments against it too. I think one of the famous ones was Roosevelt.
Yeah. I'm not familiar with what he said.
I forgot exactly, but we know there are great thinkers who have never traveled before.
Oh, yeah.
So we know it can be done. Like,
sure.
You know, the requirements for deep and meaningful thoughts, traveling doesn't have to be there. I guess that's what I'm saying. You know,
sure.
It's not a mandatory, or it's not prerequisite for it. But that doesn't mean that traveling is bad or the benefits are not real.
Sure.
Right.
I would say though, those great philosophers mm-hmm. who did not travel
mm-hmm.
In older time periods.
You think they could have done better?
Yes. Only here's the only thing right. though, because time has changed mm-hmm. the ability to travel for the, mm-hmm. the world drastically.
Yeah.
So the accessibility of traveling mm-hmm. now is greater than it's ever been.
Yeah.
It's almost, you know, I know it's not a one-to-one comparison,
mm-hmm.
but nowadays, if you live in a country like the U.S.
Uh-huh.
and you have means to make money, save money,
mm-hmm.
and actually go and do these things, it's as accessible as reading mm-hmm. a book is.
Yeah.
It really is.
Yeah.
If you're willing to put effort into it. And I think a lot of these philosophers
right.
would have,
mm-hmm.
again, traveled in that regard with the accessibility
yeah.
being
be.
What it is now. And a lot of philosophers did travel
mm-hmm.
as well, you know, ones that had money, right? So,
yeah.
again, a lot of the philosophers, depending on what generational.
And the convenience as well, right?
Yeah,
I mean,
of
back
course.
Then it was not like they could fly, right?
Yeah, so. Exactly. And, you know, they also may not have realized the vast complexness
mm-hmm.
of life, because they weren't exposed to it. You know,
right.
they got their information, their representation mm-hmm. of reality,
yeah.
not only through the ideas and what mm-hmm. they thought, but through the reality they engaged with.
Right.
So we're offered such a unique opportunity to engage with a very mm-hmm. different slice of reality than
yeah.
anybody who's before us has. And
yeah.
the ideas that will come from it potentially can be different.
Yeah.
You know, they can be great. I'm not saying necessarily greater, worse,
mm-hmm.
but different. And that alone is exciting.
Yeah.
You could have an idea that somebody else is, you know, maybe never packaged in that way.
Mm-hmm.
Or an idea that's never been
yeah.
thought before.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe unlikely, but, you know, I think worthy of investigation.
Yeah.
And I like what
sure.
you said about traveling with all your senses, because
mm-hmm.
it reminds me of a quote from Confucius, who mm-hmm. said, wherever you go, go with all your heart.
Mm.
I think that's the biggest one.
Yeah.
You know, and I know trying to define the heart is very difficult.
Yeah.
So when I say that, I hope right. I hope it can speak in a way that's understandable mm-hmm. with your heart, you know, intention, openness,
yeah. determination,
care. Yeah. You know, purpose, a lot of these
meaning,
yeah, yeah. these positive yeah. attributes. Yeah. That's what we want to have yeah. when we go to these places.
Yeah.
And I think that's just wonderful.
That's awesome. Yeah. I mean, it's just, I think more awesome knowing that he lived over 2,000 years ago, right?
It's still applicable today.
I mean, even back then, imagine how hard it was to make a trip, right?
Yeah. I mean, even going back to Heraclitus, mm-hmm. he said, those who wish to know about the world must learn about it in its particular details.
Mm-hmm.
That alone, particular details,
yeah.
unique, mm-hmm. anecdotal.
Yeah.
These are the type of details he's referring to.
Yeah.
You know, you can have a statistical and a quantitative view mm-hmm. of the world. Absolutely.
Yeah.
I mean, we can Google, we can find mathematical data
yeah.
to suggest specific things about the world.
Yeah.
But that doesn't even come close to capturing what the real actually, or sorry, what the world actually is.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why, you know, a lot of people are dismissive of anecdotal data.
Yeah.
But isn't that what kind of propels us to keep living life, to want
yeah.
to live?
Yeah.
The feeling of experience, the way we interface with the quantitative,
yeah,
more so than just the quantitative in and of itself.
Yeah.
You know, denied of emotion in all its complexity.
Yeah.
I just want to engage with that world.
Yeah. I think, you know, the great thing about traveling is that when we talk about life, we typically talk about two things, like in a broad way.
Mm-hmm.
One is meaning or purpose, mm-hmm. and the other one is happiness. Like, people sometimes debate which one's more important, which one you should, you know, go after, right? Certainly, you and I agree that happiness is not most fundamental part of life. Or yeah. because happiness can come in a shallow way, too. That's why, right? Yeah. I mean, it doesn't really require meaning or purpose to be happy. But anyway, I'm not really going into that direction of discussion. But the great thing about traveling is that it catches both, right?
Yeah.
And that's why traveling is so awesome, so exciting.
It's two birds with one stone.
Yeah. I mean, you can create, I mean, whether or not, I mean, there are so many different ways of traveling that can be relayed to, you know, meaning or purpose of life.
Mm-hmm.
But certainly it can impact your perspective. And in that sense, also related to, you know, meaning or purpose of your life.
Yeah. Yeah,
in a sort of indirect way. I mean, it could be, there could be dramatic events that can directly impact your purpose of your life, for sure. That can happen, but that's unlikely, right?
Mm-hmm.
But at least it can impact your perspective and, you know, ideas,
yeah.
views and things like that. So I would argue that it is at least indirectly related to how you can form or modify or adjust your purpose.
Yeah, yeah. No, you're absolutely right.
Yeah.
And I would say, I mean, I would argue travel is a necessity to live a good life. And again, mm-hmm. you don't necessarily have to travel thousands of miles to get this yeah. experience culturally.
Yeah.
You can travel regionally to yes. such vastly different areas.
Yeah.
Even within the U.S., there are subsects of different people yeah. and groups of people and ideologies.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you go to the South, you go to the Northeast, West Coast.
Mm-hmm.
There's so many different things here.
Absolutely.
And the cool thing is, yeah. because we live in the U.S. with a diverse melting pot of people, mm-hmm. you can just go to Absolutely. A different community.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. You know, go to the local, you know, China Mart and things like that, you mm-hmm. know, the districts.
Yeah.
There's tons of different cultures and people that mm-hmm. still celebrate their heritage
mm-hmm.
today. And you yeah. can really catch and grab a glimpse of that without mm-hmm. leaving far from home. And that might propel you to be like, oh shit, man, I want to go see actual Spain, or mm-hmm. I want to go to Korea. You know, like, I really enjoy aspects of this culture. Right. I want to go there
right.
and be a part of it, you mm-hmm. know? And you might find community in different cultures because they have different value systems, mm-hmm. things that you would have maybe never imagined.
Yeah, that's a good point. I mean, you don't have to really fly out of the country to experience other cultures. I mean, the U.S. is probably one of the best countries in that sense, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because we're so diverse here. Like even in here in Phoenix.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, and we've got a lot of differences here. You know, there's a strong Hispanic culture here, Mexican culture. And then there's also a Korean culture here as well. Yeah.
Bigger than, I think, in Austin.
Yeah, sure. I think you're right. I think Phoenix generally is just bigger than Austin.
That's why, the bigger city.
And, I mean, it's just incredibly valuable. And, you know, Aristotle, one of the basically the founding fathers of modern Western civilization, he said, a venture is worthwhile. You know? So even these guys that are super scientific, super philosophical, all these guys can still see the appeal of traveling and adventure. And I think that's one thing that, you know, I think a lot of people feel like they were born in the wrong time period. You know, we've gone to the moon. Every mountain's been conquered. All the land's been explored. You know, what's my purpose? What's my calling? There is no more adventurers. And I would say you're just looking at the world in the wrong way. There's a lot that's been undiscovered, a lot that's left unexplored, even for you personally.
Well, like, that's the point, personally, right? I mean, it doesn't matter who has done it, who has seen what. It's you who should experience it. And that is completely different from anybody else's experience.
That personal exploration, that personal adventure is so powerful and compels you. And I mean, if you've never done this before, I think you do it one time and you're you're going to be hooked. You're going to want to keep doing it. You know, and you can find that adventure in more than just travel. Again, you can find that adventure in reading, you know, maybe a book you wouldn't normally read, something that's going to engage you, or pick up a hobby. Like for us, it's rock climbing. You know, we're going to go do some multi-pitch climbing soon, and that's adventure. You know, even though it's something literally thousands of people can do, have access to, and we're not doing anything special. We're going to have that personal experience and that journey. And it's going to have its own hardships, its own joys, its own stories that make up our lives and the people around us. And that's freaking awesome. Nobody has to write me down in the history book for me to enjoy life or to get the most out of it or to find the adventure, you know, and find the fulfillment in travel, in the exploration of concepts and ideas and the experience. And I just don't think we can say it enough, but life is about the experience, you know, avoiding being essentially a simulation and challenging that, challenging yourself.
Yeah. I think, you know, personally, I think in terms of that getting experience, there are, you know, I think two things are probably the best ones. One is reading and the other one is traveling. To me, those are the most impactful when it comes to experience. Because honestly, traveling is awesome. Don't get me wrong. I would still prefer traveling over anything else. And I think a lot of people would agree. I mean, at least that's probably the single most desired method, right? Anybody. But, you know, as an adult and, you know, living a normal life here, typically it is not that easy to make a lot of trips, right?
No.
So that's why I think reading is really important, and the most convenient way to do it. But traveling, if you can, you should, starting with, you know, most convenient ones, and then you can expand that to, you know, the country and things like that. But that requires a lot of plans, right? Plannings and
it does.
Money, and there are so many things.
Yeah, but they're all things that can be saved up for.
Yeah. Again, I mean, with a good planning, it can be done.
Yeah. To plug somebody, you know, Nomadic Matt, he's got a whole bunch of good travel guides out there, how to do it cheaply, you know, abroad and everything like that, and a strong community. So there's people that do this with almost no money. I mean, if you've ever heard of a dirt bag, people that literally don't even maintain jobs for the most part, or if they do, they're seasonal, just so they can go camp and travel and see, you know, and really lean into their hobbies and their passions.
And then you can work while you're traveling. You
know? There's a lot of options and opportunities to go to farms.
Don't get me wrong. I mean, we're not, you know, making this more like unrealistically doable. I mean, traveling could be really hard. I mean, for a lot of people, you know, I mean, just living paycheck to paycheck and, you know, like it could be a really hard thing to do.
I just don't want the hardship to dissuade people. Because no matter what you choose to do in your life, whether it's travel, getting in shape, starting a business, picking up an instrument, learning a new language, reading a new book. It's going to be hard. Like, that is the prerequisite. That is like the most basic entry bar.
Yeah.
Is like there's going to be difficulty and challenges. Right. Right. And oftentimes, if you don't have those things,
mm-hmm.
you might be, and I'm not saying you're always doing this, but you might be wasting your time.
Yeah.
I will say, if there are no challenges in your life at all, mm-hmm. you're probably wasting your life. Mm-hmm. That's a pretty strong statement, but
yeah,
it's hard for me to imagine a world where you don't have challenges, mm-hmm. strife, grief, hardships,
yeah,
and you still are getting the most out of life.
Yeah.
Because unfortunately, mm-hmm. I would say fortunately, these things are married to hardship.
Mm-hmm.
Like growth is married to hardship. You have to suffer somewhat in some of your things in order to grow as a person.
Yeah, 100%.
I mean, in any skill set almost.
Yeah. Again, you know, happiness and meaning are meaningful life or meaning in general are two different things. You know, when you have a stress and difficulties and hardships, you may not be happy at the moment, but what you get out of that can create meaning for your life. And it's way more deeper and way more, you know, impactful on your life than just being happy.
Yeah.
You know, don't get me wrong. I mean, I'm not really downgrading, you know, the importance of happiness, but aiming for just happiness alone is not the answer for, you know, having a good life.
Yeah.
That's what I'm trying to get.
Absolutely. There's varying degrees, like you mentioned before, mm-hmm. of happiness. You can have a very, and we talked about this on an earlier episode, you know, the guy who's on the couch eating potato chips, binge watching.
Watching his favorite shows every day, you know.
That guy's probably pretty happy.
Exactly.
Right. But
yeah,
most people, I think, can understand mm-hmm. there's a lack of complexity and maturity to that happiness.
Yeah.
And again, I'm not going to mm-hmm. I'm not going to berate you if that's how you choose to become happy and engage in it.
Mm-hmm. Okay, we're back. We have some disturbance from outside, but we're good to go. So anyway, I don't know what we're talking about, but I was going to talk about, okay, so today's topic is travel, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then some may think that, okay, why are you guys talking about traveling right now? Because
in a pandemic of all times, you psychopaths.
Exactly. I mean, possibly it's the worst time ever to talk about traveling, but I think it could be possibly the best time, right? Because first, I think it's could be the best time because it's less competitive now. I mean, the number of travelers is definitely lower than before, right? I mean, there are some difficulties associated with it, but it's, you know, it's doable. And that's another thing, right? It's not undoable. It's not impossible. So speaking of which, we're going to talk about, because obviously this topic is very relatable to us right now because we're trying to go to Thailand. And we've gone through the process, by the way.
We have, yeah.
We talked about it on the last episode, I think, briefly. But everything was approved. Everything was good. You know, we got the green light. But we had to cancel the entire trip because we, you know, tested positive for COVID. But some may, you know, could be curious of, like, okay, how that works exactly, like traveling to Thailand, because Thailand is one of the most desired countries in the world, right?
Probably one of the biggest.
Want to explain that a little bit?
Yeah, so like you were saying, I do think right now is one of the most opportunistic times to travel.
Yeah.
Purely because tourism's been reduced due to the difficulty to enter a lot of these countries, a lot more stringent requirements and things of that nature. But in turn, you'll be able to see a lot of beautiful things without a great crowd.
Mm-hmm.
Exactly. Grant, you'll probably have a mask on, but still,
yeah.
You're not there to take pictures without your mask, are you?
Mm-hmm.
You're there for the cultural experience, the learning, the fun, the enjoyment.
Right.
You know, your ideas challenged.
Mm-hmm.
To be a modern day Hemingway. But
yeah,
so I'm putting together a video to explain how you can get to Thailand. So I'll briefly touch on that.
Okay.
First and foremost, you got to get approval through the Thai government. But before they even will grant you approval, and there's several different ways you can go.
Mm-hmm.
There's a test and go method, which requires you to have a COVID test 72 hours beforehand, not an antigen, but RT-PCR. Mm-hmm. And then once that's complete, once you finally get there, you have to stay in a approved SHA plus approved, so a government approved quarantine location, which this applies to many hotels and things of that nature. Very easy to find.
Right.
after spending the first day there, you'll be tested again. Mm-hmm. You know, isolate it, test it. If you pass, you're good. You can freely roam the country. Mm-hmm. And they're bringing this back February 1st. It was suspended sometime mm-hmm. in December.
Yeah.
Because of the variant scare, but mm-hmm. they're starting to realize there may not be as many concerns as previously thought with this variation. Mm-hmm. So in conjunction with that, you also have to have the booking pre-approved before mm-hmm. you submit all the paperwork to the Thai government. So yeah. this is booking for the SHA Plus approved hotel right. that I spoke about beforehand. Mm-hmm. You have to have your plane tickets, right? Because you have to submit that as well with it so they can know when you're arriving, flight numbers, mm-hmm. departure destination, arrival, blah, blah, blah. And then on top of that, you also need to be vaccinated or proof of recovery from COVID mm-hmm. in the last amount of 90 days.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of things that go into it, along yeah. with travel insurance to protect you up to $50,000 in case you do get catch COVID. Mm-hmm. And then once you get all that, you submit it and you wait from 7 to 10 days to get your approval mm-hmm. or your denial. And you have to do this for each individual that's going. So you can't do it for just a group. But I found that most of the people in the Thai government are pretty responsive.
Yeah.
Even if they don't get to you right away, they mm-hmm. do eventually get back to you.
Right.
So there's some real accessibility to get there. Mm-hmm. And, you know, this, of course, is going to be varying from which country you fly in from yeah. because some have less stringent requirements. If you're flying from the U.S., it's not too bad. But there might be some other countries yeah. that specifically have dealt with this variant, such as Africa, mm-hmm. that may be barred entry currently.
Yeah.
And again, things are changing so rapidly. So mm-hmm. you do need to stay up to date on what Absolutely. That government's doing.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm.
Don't just buy your ticket and assume you're going to be good because then you're going to end up in a poor situation.
Right.
Or you might get there and get
right.
turned right back around and wasted yeah. all that money. Or, you know, worst case scenario, you might end up mm-hmm. in a government facility,
yeah.
you know, without, I'm not saying this is the Thai government, but depending where you're traveling to, you don't want that, right?
Right.
So it can be difficult to get into these countries, but from everything I've read, people, mm-hmm. you know, got their feet on the ground. Life is mostly normalized
yeah.
still there. Yeah, you have right. a mask on. You know, some bars and clubs aren't fully open, but I guess a lot are.
Yeah.
So, yes, again, mm-hmm. there's another bar of entry or more difficulty yeah. to travel right now.
Yeah.
This is pretty much the case for every country,
yeah.
but it's still accessible.
Yeah.
But guess what? All the other people are going, it's too much work, man. I'm not, mm-hmm. I don't want to go travel. I got to do all this stuff. Yeah. Nah, I'm good. But you and I have been to a lot of places. One of the most annoying thing about beautiful places that you don't see represented in these pictures is that there's literally a line mm-hmm. of hundreds, if not thousands of people
yeah.
waiting to take that picture.
Yeah.
Because everybody goes to these places.
Yeah.
And right True. Now, probably the only time in your life that you can go to some of the most amazing destinations mm-hmm. and be one of the few people there.
Yeah.
A very rare opportunity. Also, you can support businesses because a lot of people overseas in these remote places that mm-hmm. are beautiful destinations rely on tourism yeah. and tourist money.
Yeah.
So you can actually help. Again, you know, economics not everything, mm-hmm. but this is a, like, literally you're helping families.
Yeah.
Potentially if you travel.
Yeah, that's a great point.
Of course, be responsible mm-hmm. when you do mm-hmm. this. You know, adhere to their standards and mm-hmm. their cultural norms and practices because it's different from where we are. Mm-hmm. You have to understand that when you go yeah. somewhere, your rights and the way you think of rights mm-hmm. are not the same.
Absolutely.
So just be mindful, you know? But I really do think you're running into potentially the best time of your life to travel.
Yeah.
If you're willing to go right now.
Yeah.
And you're going to find like-minded people because they mm-hmm. also went through the same difficulties.
Yeah.
It's not as simple as just clicking and getting a ticket anymore. So.
So, yeah, to that point, I wanted to add that, you know, probably it's really, probably it's better to have an insurance on your tickets, you know, mm-hmm. Because sometimes you have to cancel it, like, a day before your trip, mm-hmm. In which case, mostly you can't really get refund, you know? Yeah. And also another thing is that when you get travel insurance and other things, make sure that you read the cancellation policy, right? Yeah. So that, you know, you don't really lose money fully.
Right? Yeah. Research and look up whatever insurance company you're going with. Mm-hmm. Google that insurance company and then the bad things in regards to their claims or their cancellations. And you'll find out even some of the biggest ones are pretty scummy. and almost like scams.
Mm-hmm.
Trust me, I went through the process of having to cancel things with all the proper documentation. I ended up having to call my bank to get reinstated my funds because they were doing sketchy, shady practices. And this is a very, very well-known
one of the most popular ones.
Yeah, so just check everything. Read the negative reviews.
Yes.
And be willing to understand you're probably going to be at a total loss if something goes wrong on the trip.
Yeah.
Or you need to cancel.
Yeah. 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 That's a good point. So anyway, we're going through that process again, starting tomorrow, right?
Starting tomorrow, yeah, February 1st.
We waited until, you know, we're waiting until tomorrow is that tomorrow is the official day the Thai government announces whether or not, I mean, the Test and Go program is being revived. I mean, they announced it, but tomorrow is the official day.
So we're going to test the system with some submissions.
So before we actually buy anything, we're making sure that that goes in effect tomorrow, and then we're going to go through the process again, which should be not too hard.
Yeah, I don't think so.
Yeah.
But, you know, so we're talking about travel a lot right now. I got a question for you. How would you personally decide? Say I'm just some random guy. You know, I'm listening to this. I hear what you're saying. It sounds awesome, but I don't. There's just nowhere I really want to go, you know?
Yeah.
Like, what? How do you know where you want to go? Or what gets you excited to even try to go through this entire process to go be somewhere physically? Like, what is it?
I mean, obviously, you and I had a strong preferences when it comes to traveling, you know, because of that love for philosophy and, you know, other, I guess, entertainment, you know, aspects. So it was, you know, not too hard for us. But anyway, I'm going into really to this thing in a strange way. But, you know, if there are things that you like that are foreign, then it's easy to choose what country to go. But assuming that you don't have any of that, you don't have any preference, you don't have anything that is foreign that you like, then I would say just choose one country that is the most alien to you. Because that'll give you the best experience.
Or the worst, right?
Yeah, or the worst.
It's definitely going to be one of the two. But I mean, I err on the side of it. It's probably going to be a good experience. Even if it's bad, you're going to feel so much more appreciative for what you have.
Yeah.
You know, and the things that you've been normalized to or are more be comfortable and customized to.
Yeah.
But yeah, I think that's one place to start. Again, like we've talked about on the show before. What do you like? What calls to you? What what do you feel like in love with? You know, maybe you see a picture of a beach and it doesn't really do anything for you. White sands, you're just like, oh, hate sand. It's irritating. It gets everywhere. Ah, I don't really like that. But maybe you see a picture of some snow-capped mountains.
Yeah.
You know, maybe some hot springs.
There you go. So I'm not really lying about this, but I mean, obviously when I went to Japan, I went to, you know, anime places that I like and all that. But the only reason that I wanted, the first reason that I wanted to go to Japan was that this picture of hot springs in a mountain covered in snow doesn't look like artificially, you know, created place.
Wow.
And just when I looked at the picture, that was probably the closest the image that I could have of a heaven.
Was that Honshu? Or?
Well, I forgot the name of it.
Okay.
The place that I went is different from the picture that I saw. But when I saw the picture, I was just amazed by like what I was feeling from that picture.
Wow, from just the picture too.
Yeah, so like I gotta go to a place like this. And then, I mean, obviously it was, you know, not right away. I think it was after a couple of years because I was working, too busy. Finally made a time. Fortunately enough, that was right before COVID, you know. But I went to Korea to see my family first because it's right there. And then I went to Japan. And obviously, I made a reservation for that place, you know, a month before I went there. And then I went there. Oh, my God. I swear to God, that was the closest image that I still have of heaven.
Wow.
Most amazing experience. I mean, and fortunately enough, all the places that I went, even Tokyo, like, it wasn't snowing. I mean, it was, you know, it was not snowing. So I'm like,
temperate for the season.
Yeah. Oh, man. Because I was really hoping that the onsen hot springs is covered in snow.
Yeah.
So, but the onsen, I went there like second last day mm-hmm. of my trip, because the last day I left for Tokyo, because there are so many things to explore in Tokyo. So there was more than a day, but on the second last day I went to onsen. But as soon as I got out of the car train, it was snowing. I'm like,
Oh, man.
I'm a man of no luck. But today, that's not the case.
Yeah.
And then, sure enough, they had this limo. Is that limo, right? Limo? Like a bus that provided by the company. Okay. I don't know why, but that word just sounded so strange to me. But anyway, we took their bus. You know, really hilly place, probably took us like an hour to get there. And I mean, along the way too, covered in snow and monkeys. I was really surprised to see monkeys there. But when I got there, the actual onsen, completely covered in snow, man.
Mm.
And the place, there were several spots of onsens. It didn't, like, their design was like the least intrusive to nature.
Oh, wow. So it just
didn't look like artificially, you know, created at all. Like, it just looked like actual natural hot springs, you know?
Wow.
But when I was in the water, for a long time. But it was snowing too.
Wow.
Anyway, that was probably the best experience I've ever had.
And to think all that from just the feelings you got when you saw a picture.
Yeah.
I'm telling you, it's almost magical in that way, that sometimes we get these little insights from our reality, or, you know, again, I don't like being spiritual woo type thing, but it almost feels destiny, you know, you almost feel like called to that place.
Right.
And when you really lean into that and you kind of, you pay homage to that feeling, you pay respect to yourself to feel that way. And you get something really beautiful out of it when you take that level of authenticity and genuineness to say, no, what I felt from this picture was more than just seeing a picture of beauty. Mm. You had to go experience it.
Yeah.
And it propelled you. Even though you said it took a couple of years, planning, job, and all those things, you still got a deep satisfaction out of that.
Yeah.
So maybe, you know, somebody out there listening right now, maybe there's been one place you've been, since you were a kid, you wanted to go. You know, maybe think about that. You know, when I was a kid, was there somewhere I wanted to go? Maybe there is. Maybe there's somewhere like deep in your heart that's just been covered by the burden of responsibility of life.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know? And there's still somewhere deep in you that has that childlike wonder. And when you're going to be brought back into it, you're going to feel so happy and thankful you gave that gift to yourself.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, it really has the power, again, I know I keep saying this, to change your life in such a more beautiful and complex way.
Mm-hmm.
And all it takes is really just being honest with yourself. Yeah. Like, I can be moved. Pictures can have impact. I can feel things. Mm-hmm. I can feel desire. I can feel passions to want to go and explore, to be an adventure, you know, to be a kid again in some ways. And so, yeah, like you're saying, I'd go through Google Images, beautiful places. And just search through the images, you know, until something catches your eye.
Mm-hmm.
And then go look into it. Yeah, why does it catch my eye?
Mm-hmm.
And maybe the picture alone is enough. Or you can do more research to really solidify what you want to do.
Mm-hmm.
But just be cautious that you don't over-research yourself out of going and gaining the personal experience. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Because, you know, like Good Will Hunting, you know, one of our favorite movies.
Yeah.
When Robin Williams is talking to Matt Damon's character, Will, you know, saying, I bet you could tell me everything that's ever been written.
Yeah.
Basically on the Sistine Chapel. I'm paraphrasing here, but you know, you could basically tell me every single thing, like historic critiques, art critiques. It's like, but you know what, man? You've never stood in there. You've never smelled it. You've never taken it in.
Yeah.
And there's...
And you have no idea how you feel.
You have no idea.
Right.
You have no idea.
Yeah.
I mean, there are definitely sights in nature, even some man-made things that literally bring me to tears when I've seen them. Like such real, true beauty.
Yeah.
And I'm telling you, just like seeing a movie depict somebody feel that way is not the same as feeling it yourself.
Yeah.
Go feel it. And you may not have that. Again, you may not have that feeling, but you're going to have something. Don't you want to see if you have it?
Yeah.
You know? Don't you want to go see what you're going to feel when you're looking at the thing that you thought was a beautiful picture and you're standing in the midst of it? Do you want to see if that was an illusion, those feelings, or if they were true?
Yeah, man. I mean, the experience, actual experience is so powerful. You know, what you feel from that experience alone is powerful. It can never be replaced by anything else.
Yeah.
Like the moment that I was there in Hot Springs, getting snow on my face, that can be never replaced by anything, any description, because I know how it feels.
Yeah.
You know? And, I mean, I had some sake right before that a little bit. It felt great. And great foods. But the point is, at the moment, what you're feeling is so powerful. But also, even after a year, 2 years, you still remember it. The remembering thing, the memory, is so much different from the memory of words. You know, the memory of senses.
Yeah.
They're two different things. And it's so powerful. And it's going to be in you forever.
Yeah.
You can never forget that. You know,
ever. It's so wonderful. And to think, you know, the experience we're talking about, this doesn't only apply to traveling. We're just talking about traveling in this episode.
Mm-hmm.
But I think anybody listening to this that's listened to our stuff can tell this recurring theme that we're telling you to get out there and experience life. Yes. You know? Look, we have a podcast talking about go and do it because we're doing it. We're like, yo, it's not enough to like just feel this way. It's just like we were talking about earlier. Hey, man, it's not enough that you and I discuss this and talk about this all the time. Like, we need to let other people know like how powerful these experiences are, because I think we're all so very aware of it, but we're also so out of touch. Like, we know it intellectually to be true, but in our hearts and via our experience, we're not living it, you know? So we lack that aspect of the truth. We've got one part of the truth, but we're missing the other half.
Right.
And when these two things come together in marriage, you know, like what you said, what dojo means, the when the path meets the way.
Right. Oh, dojo means place of the way.
Place of the way. Yeah. So when, you know, the path and the way meet, that's when it feels like everything is in harmony.
Yeah,
you
man.
Know, like even our lives, like we have our difficulties. Obviously, you know, Thailand was canceled. We've been sick.
Yeah.
You know, lost a friend. We've had a lot of hardships. But despite all that, because we feel we're on the right path and we feel this experience is so important and sharing it with other people, we're willing to suffer those grievous losses.
Mm-hmm.
And they only fail to add more value and meaning towards it.
Mm-hmm.
And then we get you get subtle reminders all the time. Mm-hmm. You know, somebody reaches out to you and says, hey, man, I heard your stuff. Love what you guys are doing. You know, these small little bits of encouragement.
Mm-hmm.
Things that are totally seemingly unrelated, but somehow remind you like, oh, thank God, this was the right choice. And again, I hate saying things like, oh, the universe will remind you. But I will say in our experience, in especially the last few months, it does feel like there are such strong indicators that are totally out of our control. And again, maybe it's just because of being more open to it. But yeah, you're doing the right thing. But it takes that one step. It's like, I believe it's Lao Tzu that said, you know, a journey of 1,000 or 10,000 steps or 10,000 miles starts with the first step.
Yeah, something like that.
I might, I'm the philosopher, I forgot. Well,
people get it,
the name. But yeah, man, you gotta take some real efforts to step out there and just do it. And yeah, sometimes things do not go right. Sometimes you get hurt, you know, physically, emotionally, mentally. But as long as you persist, man, just keep persisting. Something is going to work out and pay off. Or you're going to have at least the obvious sign and the answer that, yeah, I've tried that. It wasn't for me. Let's change direction. I know that doesn't work.
Yeah.
I know that's not the way for me.
Mm-hmm.
And that is just as valuable as the way.
Mm-hmm.
Because you can't have one without the other.
Yeah.
Like, you really need these things in comparison to each other. You know, and again, that's why the experience of travel is so valuable. You now have all these new sensations, these new ideas, these new beliefs, new thoughts, and you can compare it against the way you've been living your life for X amount of years.
Yeah.
How awesome. You can basically start a new life.
Yeah.
Because you can have these two things merge and fuse into a beautiful new thing. You can have some more identity. You can make some more choices.
Yeah.
Because you have options you never realized existed before. So freaking cool.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, we said that said this earlier, but, like, it doesn't have to be an international trip.
No.
You know? Like, I mean, in the U.S., too, there are so many beautiful places, right?
Dude, weren't we just out 2 days ago?
Yeah.
Out in a boulder field, you know? South Mountain here in Phoenix, mm-hmm. For people that know climbing area, you're just in this like obscure area with all these rocks,
mm-hmm.
and you know, it's a desert, but in between that desert, we found what appears to be, you know, where a river was at one point, a riverbed, yeah. you know, smooth rocks, vegetation changed. Mm-hmm. I feel like I'm in a completely different place.
Mm-hmm.
And it was only 40 minutes from us.
Yeah.
You know, that's plus true. A hike in, but I would have never known that place existed unless we were willing to go out and be like, yo, let's go check some stuff out. Let's go look around.
Mm-hmm.
And what a beautiful experience we had from that.
Mm-hmm.
And it just makes my, you know, sense of the area
mm-hmm.
that much more complete. I feel better even being here, knowing that's there and that we can go have access to it.
Yeah.
It's a wonderful feeling.
Yeah. True. And then, you know, like possibly because of the pandemic, right? You may experience something very different, unique to this time. You know, I was going to just talk about that a little bit because, you know, all the any number of historical events have really, you know, helped to shape the culture of, I mean, in this case, Western culture. But I mean, historical events usually have an impact on culture, right? Mm-hmm. The Black Death, for example, of the 1300s, caught the European population by up to like one half, right? Mm-hmm. Resulting in the invigoration of Christianity, you know, with the theme of like apocalyptic themes.
Mm-hmm.
And also, in addition, the labor scarcity, really, you know, the disruption of the routes between east and west, you know, all that. I mean, look at like this one historical event, what it did,
right?
So pandemic, it seems like, yes, it's universal now, but everybody's processing it differently. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, there are some themes in there, like there are some problems in there. We see, you know, this, the rise of discrimination against, you know, a lot of all sorts, basically race,
and,
you know, the economic differences, it seems more radical now, you know, all those themes, like you can't, I'm not saying that these are the most important thing to experience, but what I'm saying is that we're in the middle of this very important and unique historical event. Yeah. And during this time, possibly you can experience very unique, you know, things right now in other countries.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And in regard to that, you know, I feel called to bear witness,
mm-hmm.
you know, physically bear witness to what's going on in life.
Yeah.
I'm not going to let somebody's movie, somebody's music,
mm-hmm.
somebody's book tell me what life is.
Yeah.
I'm going to go physically bear witness to it.
Yeah.
And make my own experience and choice about what that life is, and what it means. Because it can be segmented in so many different ways.
Mm-hmm.
But what a rare opportunity for you and I to go there and say, well, what does life actually look like?
Mm-hmm.
Filter through me, through my personal experience,
mm-hmm.
through where I am right now.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, what a cool thing.
Yeah. And again, we're, you know, planning to go to Thailand. Of course, it's awesome to go there. Don't get me wrong. But also, you know, in relation to podcasts that we're doing, we've been emphasizing the importance of experience. But, you know, if we don't do what we're saying is important, then what's the point, right?
Then we're just a bunch of guys talking, you know, like
exactly.
just bullshitting with mics. That. Yeah.
Right. So that's what we're trying to show our audience. And, you know, the most important thing, having fun, right?
Yeah.
Right. So we encourage you to travel right now if you can afford, you know, anywhere you haven't been, right? Yeah. I mean, that's the thing.
Dude, you go camp for the weekend.
Yeah. That too, right? Yeah.
You go camp. That's pretty much free. Yeah. Unless you need gear.
Mm-hmm.
And if you can't do that, you have a car. Can you sleep in it? Can you put a seat down?
Yeah.
Can you get your, you know, pillows, absolutely. Covers?
Mm-hmm.
There's so many different ways to have travel and exploration in your life.
Yeah. The point is, go out there that you haven't been in before. Get some new experience.
Yeah. Right? I would love that's to hear point. About them. We want to hear.
Yeah.
Tell us about your experiences.
Yeah.
So
I think that's it for today.
Yeah. Until next time.
All right. Thank you. That's this week's episode of the Theory of Living podcast. Thanks for listening with us. We are Lafayette and Kai. Don't forget to join us next week for another episode.
And if you'd like to help support us, we have a Patreon page where you can subscribe for exclusive content.
Also, please share it with others who you think may find value in our discussion.
Leave a rating, a review, and please subscribe to the podcast.
Thank you again.
See you next time.